Very good afternoon to all. On behalf, I'm Dr. Chaturani Vikramarachchi, and on behalf of the Council of College of Community Physicians in Sri Lanka, I warmly welcome all of you today for the second Journal Club activity of the year, conducted and organized by the College of Community Physicians in Sri Lanka. As we all know, we are all currently facing the biggest pandemic in the 21st century. Worldwide, as millions of people are encouraged to stay at home to minimize transmission of COVID-19 infection, healthcare workers are prepared to do the exact opposite. Therefore, it is a timely need to assess the clinical outcomes and risk factors for SARS-CoV-19 infection among healthcare workers. So, ladies and gentlemen, with this thought, we have selected the journal article for today's Journal Club activity, COVID-19 Healthcare Workers, a Systematic Review and Meta-Analysis. This journal article was originally published in the International Journal of Infectious Diseases in the January 2021 edition, done by a group of researchers from United Arab Emirates, led by Dr. Mandana Golami. Today, we have a distinguished panel of three public health specialists who have kindly accepted our invitation to attend this panel club activity as panel members amidst their busy work schedule. Ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce you to the panel members for today's session. These public health specialists do not need extensive further introductions. The panel members for today are Professor Vasantha Gunatunga, Professor in Community Medicine from the Faculty of Medicine, University of Colombo; Dr. Vindhya Kumarapelli, Specialist in Community Medicine, who is also the Director of Non-Communicable Disease Unit at Ministry of Health; and Dr. Sumal Nandasena, Specialist in Community Medicine, who is the Deputy Regional Director of Health Services, Kalutara. So, to begin today's proceedings, I cordially invite the three panel members to introduce our two presenters and to share a few words of wisdom with this gathering to encourage and facilitate academic endeavors and continuous professional development amidst COVID-19 pandemic. Over to you, Madam and Sir.
Sir.
Thank you, Chaturani. Yeah. Thank you, Chaturani. And it's a pleasure to see you all again in this wonderful meeting. Of Journal Club, and I welcome my colleagues Vindhya and Sumal to the panel. Good afternoon, Vindhya. Good afternoon, Sumal.
Good afternoon. Good afternoon, sir.
Now we have this Journal Club today. We are going to discuss about COVID-19 published article, a systematic review. Today we have two of our young colleagues presenting. That's Dr. Chiara Pereira and Dr. Shahnaz Taslim, who are masters in community medicine, two of our master's graduates, got their master's in 2020. And currently they are working attached to the provincial director's office, working for COVID-19 prevention and control activities and maternal and child health. They have presented previously, also I remember, something on a systematic review. So they have a wealth of experience. So let me very happily and proudly introduce these two young colleagues for the Journal Club today. Over to you.
Thank you, Professor Gunatunga, for that introduction. Good afternoon, respected panel of judges and ladies and gentlemen. I'm Dr. Shiara, myself and Dr. Shana as my colleague. We would be presenting to you during this journal club on the COVID-19 and healthcare workers, a systematic review and meta-analysis article. And we would like to take this opportunity to thank the College of Community Physicians for giving us this opportunity to share our journal club with you all. To begin with, a brief outline about on how the proceedings would follow. We would start by explaining what a journal club is and its importance, and also what we have done up to now. And finally, the most important part of critically appraising the article we have selected. So let's explore what a journal club is. As you can see, it's an educational meeting of a group of individuals who discuss on current articles and provide a forum for a collective effort to keep up with the literature. So I would like to highlight the fact that it is not only to keep up with the literature, but it also discusses on the articles that are updated frequently. So a little bit about the origin of journal clubs. As you can see, it has a history of more than 150 years, where Sir William Osler established the first journal club in 1875 at the McGill University. So according to Bhattacharya's article, Journal Club and Postgraduate Medical Education, a journal club serves three purposes. To begin with, it teaches and develops the skills of critical appraisal. It increases the exposure to rapidly evolving medical literature, and it also helps to be informed during clinical practice. So during the course of our preparation, we began the point of journal club by choosing a relevant article, which was followed by choosing the relevant reporting guideline for the article we chose. And we would like to thank the coordinator of the journal club of the college for circulating our article among you all through the secretary of the College of Community Physicians of Sri Lanka. And we also seek expert opinion from our expert panel. The first step of choosing the relevant article, as stated before, we wanted to focus on an important area of discussion in the current day, and it's obvious that it's the exposure of the healthcare workers to the COVID-19 infection, and we came across this article which we found. And a little background about this article is this focuses on the challenges and the risks the frontline healthcare workers are exposed to during the pandemic. And they have briefly gone through, a brief description would be, they have gone through three databases to select the articles, and accumulation of more than 119,000 healthcare workers have been included in the study. And they have analyzed both, there is a quantitative and a qualitative aspect to this review. And they have gone in to look at the symptoms the healthcare workers have got. And because majority, like almost 50% of the healthcare workers have been tested positive according to this study. And they have also looked into the outcomes, especially the hospitalization, discharge, and the death of healthcare workers who were exposed to the COVID-19 infection. And they conclude by stating that there's an increased risk of the healthcare workers with the infection, and also that we need to keep updating on the information in order to track the trends of healthcare workers with the evolving pandemic. As you can see, this article had been included in the International Journal of Infectious Diseases, and the journal matrix shows that it has an impact factor of 3.6. And this article was received in November 2020, but following revision, finally accepted in January 2021. According to Science Direct, you can see it has been cited 31 times and 32 times according to PubMed up to now. After we chose our article, the next step was to choose the relevant reporting guidelines. So we used the Equator Network website, which is a repository of the reporting guidelines. And since our article is a systematic review with the meta-analysis component, we chose the PRISMA 2020 checklist to praise our article. You can see two images of the checklist, and it comprises of 27 items under each as a accumulation of each section. The circulation of the article was done through the college, through this flyer, where you have access to the article as well for your reference. So let's come to the most important part of our journal club, which is the appraisal of the article. We came up with a template which we could follow based on the 27 items which were on the PRISMA checklist in order to guide our appraisal, and this template would follow as we check each of these components with the article we have selected. To begin with the title. The PRISMA checklist request to identify that the report as a systematic review. So as you can see, the title itself states that this is a systematic review which has a meta-analysis component. So since we have appraised the title, we would move to the abstract. For the abstract, that's a separate checklist under PRISMA 2020 for abstracts, which comprises of 12 items to be checked. And after we went through the abstract of the article, we were able to identify four deficiencies out of the 12, which are namely, the exclusion criteria was not mentioned in the abstract under the eligibility criteria. And also, even though they have stated that three databases have been searched for, they have not mentioned the names of the databases, and also the risk of no information on risk of bias have been stated in the abstract, and the limitations of evidence have also not been mentioned in the abstract. So overall, we have 8 items out of the 12 that fulfill the PRISMA 2020 abstract checklist. So let's move on to the introduction section, starting with the rationale. The checklist recommends to describe the rationale for this review based on the existing knowledge. So as I have highlighted here, they have identified that the proper protection of healthcare workers against this infection and the importance of prioritizing the protective protocols for the healthcare workers have been stated. And also, even though they have said that many studies have been done with this regard, it would have been better if the article stated that this review would bridge the gaps between these facts in order to provide a cumulative analysis of the findings of these studies. With reference to the objectives under the introduction section, the checklist expects to provide an explicit description on the objectives or the questions that have been reviewed in this study. So they clearly state that this systematic review is done on the published data with a meta-analysis component to determine the risk and the clinical outcomes of the infection among the frontline healthcare workers. Since we have completed the appraisal of the introduction section, let's move on to the methods section. So starting off with the eligibility criteria. The guideline specifies the inclusion and exclusion criteria to be presented and how the studies were grouped for the synthesis. So under the eligibility criteria component under methods, they have selected full text peer reviewed articles which have been published since the 1st of January to the 9th of July 2020, which include the impact of SARS-CoV-2 only among the healthcare working population. And also they have stated that articles that are not in English, that do not have an English translation, and the articles that do not provide comprehensive data or comments or viewpoints with this regard have been excluded from the eligibility criteria. So on the contrary, even though eligibility criteria have been stated, as the proceedings go, you will find out that in the results section, they have stated that three articles have been excluded due to the unavailability of of an English translation of articles. So this brings out the query if the non-English articles that are supposed to be excluded, if they have been accepted or not for the review, which is not mentioned in the context. So moving on to the information sources segment. The checklist recommends to specify all the sources that have been searched and also to include the last date that each source had been searched or consulted. So under the section of information sources and search strategy, they have stated that PubMed, Scopus and Google Scholar have been searched for during the period of 1st May to 9th July 2020 by 5 independent researchers. But the drawback we found was that they have not specified the date when each of the sources have been searched last. So in order to improve the search, more search engines would have been incorporated. For an example, Sinal or Embase would have been databases they would have searched for in order to broaden their the number of articles that have been collected. And also with regards to the use of Google Scholar, as we all know, that's a very common database we go for the search of articles, but it contains a lot of gray literature, which has the potential of deviating the attention of the researcher like when they're focusing on a specific topic. Moving on to the search strategy. The guideline expects to present all the full searches for all the databases and also to include the filters and limits that were used. So under the same subheading of information sources and search strategy, they have focused their search based on the broad categories of healthcare, risk, COVID-19 and miscellaneous. And they had provided their search strategies as supplementary file. So, in inquiring into the supplementary file, they had provided a table that with the key terms they have identified under each category as healthcare, risk, COVID-19 and miscellaneous, and also the example for the PubMed search strategy. So what's wrong with this reporting? What we thought was it would have been ideal if they could give the search strategies they used for the other two databases, the Scopus and the Google Scholar. And also, as I would like to highlight, all the terms that the supplementary file had were not included in the search strategy that was given. As I have highlighted here, was that the frontliners, medical staff, surveillance were not included in the PubMed search. However, how can we further improve the search? They would have used more key terms like hospital staff or medical staff, and also the use of mesh terms, which was not present in the search strategy. For an example, the word health personnel, you can see there are more than 10 entry terms under this term health personnel. And also you can see part of the mesh tree, which further illustrates that it would have covered a broader area of the search. And during a preliminary search we did, using the mesh terms, it is more likely that more articles would have been found if mesh terms were used during their search. Let's check on the selection process under the methods section. According to PRISMA 2020 guideline, they recommend to specify the methods that were used to decide how the studies met the inclusion criteria and how the reviewers screened them. So the study selection section clearly states that the full texts were selected and based on the predetermined inclusion and exclusion criteria, and it was screened using the title and the abstract. but what would have been better? The details on who did the search strategy, search selection, and the data collection processes would have been mentioned separately along with their initials, which would have been a better approach. And also, with regards to handling of discrepancies during the search strategy, search selection, and the data collection has not been mentioned, which would have ideally been mentioned in the context. The next component would be the data collection process. According to the guideline, we have to specify the methods used to collect the data from the reports and how the reviewers collected the data and how they work. So onto your left, you could see that five independent researchers have extracted the information for the quantitative aspect of the study and pulled in their data together, while six independent researchers have extracted the information needed out of the 30 articles chosen for the qualitative analysis of the review. What could have improved in this? As stated before, who did the search strategy, search selection, and the data collection processes would have ideally been mentioned along with their initials. And also, if you go through that segment, that text, you can identify that they have mentioned the deduplication process, which was done after the data extraction of the quantitative analysis. But if you compare it with the flow diagram, they have correctly placed the deduplication process before that. But ideally, the deduplication process has to be done before the data extraction process is started. And also, even though they have mentioned about six independent reviewers reviewing the qualitative component, no information on deduplication is mentioned in that. And also, the information on the extraction of publication-related data has not been stated in that section.
Okay.
Moving on to the data items under the methods section. The PRISMA guideline requests to list and define all the outcomes of data which were sought. So according to the data collection section, they have extracted data pertaining to their demographics, the clinical manifestations, the blood investigations that were carried out, and also the outcomes, which included hospitalization, discharge, and death, which were the key information that were extracted. The next part was to list and define all the other variables where data was sought. And they have also gone for the selection of papers based on the name of the authors, the year and date of publication, the study design, the publication country, as well as the total number of healthcare workers incorporated into each study. Next, we come to an important aspect of the methods section, which is the risk of bias assessment. According to the PRISMA guideline, we have to specify the methods used to assess the risk of bias in the included studies, but information on this regard, in the sense the risk of bias assessment, has not been mentioned in the methods section. Moving on to the effect measures. The guideline states that we have to specify each outcome and the effect measures and how the synthesis and presentation of results were done. So as you can see, they have used the pooled prevalence and the 95% confidence interval, even though the risk ratios are not within the scope of this article. The synthesis methods. The PRISMA criteria requests to describe the processes used to decide which studies were eligible for the synthesis, but no information on this process had been mentioned in the context. The next component under the same category was to describe any methods used to prepare and presentation of data and handling of missing summary statistics or data conversions. So they have not mentioned per se, but there is statement where they have calculated the standard deviation using a formula. So assuming it was not included in all the studies. So what was the problem with that? The equation used for the calculation according to their study was the upper limit minus lower limit over 4. So how far is it correct? Ideally, the equation they should have used was the standard deviation equals confidence interval over 3.92 into the square root of the number of participants. Another statement under the same section would be to describe any methods used to tabulate or visually represent the data. So even though it has not been mentioned in the context that specific methods will be used to display the results, in the subsequent sections, in the results section, and so they have presented each study design, study information, and the synthesis in tables. And also they have mentioned that the publication bias will be assessed using a funnel plot, so that would also be available in subsequent components. Next section was to describe any methods used to synthesize results and the rationale for the choices, and if a meta-analysis was done and the information related to the meta-analysis. So here they have clearly defined that the meta-analysis was done using the random effect model, and pool estimates have been taken with regards to prevalence and 95% confidence intervals, and also the measure of heterogeneity using the statistical methods have been stated clearly under statistical approach. So what is the drawback we identified was they have not mentioned what software was used to carry out the meta-analysis or the assessment of heterogeneity in the strategy segment shown before. The next component was to describe any possible causes of heterogeneity among the study results. So we were and the presence of any subgroup analysis or meta regression. So none of that information is mentioned in the statistical approach segment. And the possible causes for heterogeneity has not been evaluated. But it would have been better if, as a strategy, to conduct a subgroup analysis based on the profession and the location. The next segment under the same section was to describe a sensitivity analysis if it was conducted to assess the robustness of the synthesized results. But no information on the sensitivity analysis has been mentioned. So it would have been better if they should have mentioned it. And two possible ways of getting it done is by changing the cutoff values and redoing the meta-analysis, and also using the fixed effect model in addition to the random effect model and comparing their results. The next broad topic would be the reporting bias assessment. The PRISMA guideline requests to describe any methods used to assess the risk of bias to missing results in the synthesis. So they have clearly stated that the publication bias will be assessed using a funnel plot and Eggers test. The last component is the certainty assessment under the methods section. The guideline recommends to describe any methods used to assess certainty in the body of evidence, and any information with regards to certainty assessment was not mentioned in the context. And here too, it would have been better if they conducted a certainty assessment using the GRADE criteria. Now that we have praised the method section, I would like to hand over the resource section and thereafter to my colleague, Dr. Shahnaz. Over to you, Shahnaz.
Can't hear you clearly, Chiara.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chiara. So here we are moving to the results section of the PRISMA guideline. So the first component shows is the study selection. Here, We are moving to that. So here they have mentioned about the results in the first paragraph, how they have started the study selection from the May 1st of 2022, July 9th of 2020. Among them, they have explained regarding the search strategy, how they used. In the meantime, they have used the Prisma flow chart to the describing they have used the Prisma flow diagram to describe the search strategy. They have identified 328 articles. Among them, after the deduplicated, they retained 295 articles. Then they went through the two excluded rounds, and at the end of the study, they have found 30 full text review articles. And the issues they have we have found there is a breakdown of the 328 articles chosen based on the search database is not mentioned. In the meantime, the discrepancy between the text in the method section where duplicate were removed after the data extraction was shown as the second step in the flowchart. So next, we are moving to the when Prisma guideline, they recommend to cite the studies that might appear to meet the inclusion criteria. They have mentioned about the inclusion criteria, but the issues we have encountered is among the 67 articles were excluded due to lack of sufficient data being a comment or viewpoint, but the exact breakdown for each category is not available. Then we are moving to the study characteristics. Here the Prisma guideline recommend to cite the each included study and present the characteristics. Here you can see in the table one, they have include all 30 articles and they have described the characteristic which they studied. Next, moving to the risk of bias in studies. Prisma guideline recommend to present the assessment of risk of bias for each included study. As my colleague previously mentioned, risk of bias assessment has not been done. So when you're moving to the results of individual studies, the guideline recommend for the outcomes present for the each study or summary statistics for each group in a table or plots. So here, they have mentions in the table 6, causes of disease and complications. In the meantime, they have shown the narrative synthesis for the risk factors of the COVID-19 infection in the healthcare worker population. So we move into the results of synthesis. So Prisma guideline recommend for the each synthesis briefly summarize the characteristics and the risk of bias among the contributing studies. As previously mentioned, risk of bias assessment was not included in this review. Also, Prisma guideline recommend to present the results of all the statistical synthesis conducted. Here, they have used prevalence and the 95 confidence interval. Here you can see in the meta-analysis of healthcare workers, they have gone through the pooled prevalence and the confidence intervals. Also, guideline recommend to present the results of all investigation of possible causes of heterogeneity. They have used Cochrane's Q statistics, T-square and I-square. Here you can see in the table 2, meta-analysis of healthcare workers. They have gone through the 29 heterogeneity in this table. Also, the Prisma guideline recommend to present the results of the all sensitivity analysis. So, as previously mentioned, the sensitivity analysis has not been done. So now we are moving to the reporting the biases. So you can see they are recommend to present the assessment of risk of bias due to missing results. Here the funnel plot shows the death among the healthcare workers and the hospitalization of the healthcare workers. They have not mentioned the other outcomes in the funnel plot. So now we are moving to certainty of the evidence. The guideline recommend to present the assessment of certainty. As previously mentioned by my colleague, certainty assessment was not included in that review. We are moving to the discussion. So the PRISMA guideline recommend to provide a general interpretation of the results in the context of the other evidence. Here the discussion part, they have briefly discussed about the main points of the study. Also, they recommend to discuss any limitation of the evidence and also a review process used. Here, there are no limitation have been stated in relation to evidence, review process and implications. Also, PRISMA guideline recommend to discuss the implication of the results for the practice, policy and the future research. They have mentioned regarding that, but there are issues like the article only gives descriptive accounts on the finding without much information on the implication. It would have been better if the study finding could be used to recommend activities based on the results. Now we are moving to the other information. Like first component is registration and protocols. Guideline recommend to provide registration of information for the review. So here, since they are not registered, the information on the registration is not stated in context. It is better if the systematic review and meta-analysis were registered in a registry such as Prospero. Also, PRISMA guideline recommend to indicate where the review protocol can be accessed. They have mentioned regarding the PRISMA protocol, but the protocol cannot be accessed. Also, PRISMA guideline recommend to describe the explain any amendment to the information provided. Since this is not registered, it is not relevant here. Now we are moving to the support. They are recommend to describe the source of financial and non-financial support. They declare financial support as none. Then we are moving to the competing of interest. So PRISMA guideline declare regarding any competing of interest of the review authors. They clearly declare conflict of interest as none. Now we are moving to the availability of data, code and other materials. PRISMA recommend to report available of data, but here search strategy was available as a supplementary file. As a conclusion, this is our guide checklist, which we have went through the each and every item of the PRISMA 2020 checklist. We would like to thank you all for being a part of our journal club. I miss your busy schedule. Thank you so much for your participation.
Thank you very much, Yara and Shana.
I would like to thank the College of Community Physicians of Sri Lanka again for giving us this opportunity to share this journal club with you all. And the floor is open for questions.
Can I ask one question from you all? Yeah, I'm Mahesh Kumbukage, a registrar. First of all, I would like to thank both the presenters, Chiara and Shanas. Thank you. It was really well done and it was very comprehensive, and congratulations to both of you. I would like to ask actually one question, right? So we know that in systematic reviews, while for the meta-analysis, we use different
models, right? So for this systematic review, they have used the random effect model. So we know that there are different models such as fixed effect model as well. So why have they used, is there a specific reason for using this random effect model for this systematic review? Right. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Mahesh, for that question. So as we all know, every meta-analysis gives out a combined effect of the studies that are included in the review. So these are based on two assumptions, one being the fixed effect model assumption and also the other one, random effect model assumption. So if we are confident that the true effect of the true effect size is uniform across all studies, then we can go ahead with a fixed effect model assumption, but which is a common picture with all studies. The true effect varies across the study types which are included in each systematic review. So we usually go with a random effect model, and it's obvious that when there is uncertainty of the effect of each study, it's safer and more reliable to go with a random effect model assumption, even though it gives a wide confidence interval. I hope I answered your question.
Right, okay, thank you very much.
I would like to ask the next question. Thank you, presenters, for that excellent presentation. I am Dushyanti Javardhana. I'm just asking this question because there are a lot of trainees, and for the purpose so that everyone would learn from the answer. Could you please explain to us now, when we do a systematic review, how can we assess the heterogeneity? Can you, do you think you can just elaborate on that?
Thank you so much for your question. So I like to first say the heterogeneity reflects the variability. So it can be assessed by the describing as clinical or methodological or statistical. So under the clinical, mostly we see the participants or outcome or interventions. In the meantime, then the methodological assessment done through the study design and the, is there any risk of biases? Also here, as in this study, they used only the statistical assessment, kind of I squared or chi squared. So in any meta-analysis, it's better if they use all three heterogeneity to the as a report. So it will be better. Hope I answered your question.
Thank you. Right. Okay.
I also have a question. I'm Dr. Resha from RDHS office. And first of all, thank you, Shara and Shahnaz, for your excellent presentation. For the benefit of the other trainees as well, can you just elaborate a little bit more on the certainty assessment? How do we carry out?
Okay, madam, thank you so much for that question. So I'll start by the certainty assessment is how far we are confident of generalizing the effect measures. So basically, I hope I summarized that right. So this we usually start with the study design, and thereafter we categorize in the sense we upgrade or downgrade based on a set of criteria. So there are 8 criteria. So out of which there are 5 criteria that actually downgrade the certainty of a study. So this includes the imprecision, the inconsistency, the risk of bias, and also the indirectness, and also the publication bias of a study, which brings down the certainty of the study. So on the contrary, there are 3 aspects that upgrade the certainty of a study, which are the dose response gradient, and also if there's a large effect size, and also if the effect of the plausible residual confounding. So once we accumulate all these based on a grading system, we can get an automated outcome if we use tools such as a GradePro GDP, which once we provide all the data needed, they give us the certainty level based on the findings they get, which is a final assessment, which now it's done in an automated manner. I hope that was a fair explanation.
Thank you very much, Chiara and Fatima, for your excellent presentations and those wonderful and excellent answers. Because of the interest of time, we will stop there with all the questions. And I again cordially invite our panel members to give your invaluable input.
Okay. Sumar, is Gunatunga sir there?
Yes, okay. I'm there. Yeah.
Okay, anyway. Yes, please.
Yeah, you go ahead. Yes.
I was just going to, actually, it's a very interesting and very useful presentation by our junior colleague. So now you showed the table where they have gathered the articles, each article, and are there any studies from our region? And now if you look at the results, how would you interpret the results in terms of applicability to our setup? Not about the statistics or anything, I'm just asking about the interpretation of these findings to our context.
Madam, if I may, this study, even though it was done in Saudi Arabia, they have focused their studies based on the Western countries. Like all the studies, the majority of them are done in the Western countries. So when it comes to resources and the discrepancies with the other factors like socioeconomic factors, I don't know how far we can actually tally those results with our context. And also, we were not able to find very precise articles within our Asian region. I'm sure they must have done, but with time limitations and all of that, we were not able to find something that could actually fit into our context. So one doubt is how far we can imply the Western world findings with our context, and also the limitations of, I'm sure with the patient load and everything, going into research would be difficult also. It's not feasible. So the lack of information in at least the Asian region, Southeast Asian region is limited. So we were not able, and it's quite difficult to actually generalize those findings to our context.
Our context, yes. Thank you. Sir?
Yes, and I thought there was a, you said other languages have been excluded in this work.
Yes.
Other than English. You may not have, they may not have gone into detail, but proportion of research purely on the grounds of language being excluded, and how much that exclusion affect the results.
Exactly, sir. As I said before, in the inclusion and exclusion criteria, they have clearly stated that they will exclude non-English, and even if there is no English translation, they would actually exclude the study. But there is a little controversy there, because in the results section, they have said they have excluded only 3 articles because there were no English translation. So, but they have not stated that the amount of articles which were not English or that did not have the comprehensive data according to their eligibility criteria, they have not given the number that they have excluded. So there is, like we stated, that there is a query on if they have actually included the studies or not. There's a query there. So that obviously affects the results, because if they have accepted it, then you cannot imply it doesn't go with the methods, the protocol. So there's a discrepancy there, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Sumal, you want to ask anything?
Actually, I want to do a comment. So thank you very much, Chiara and Ashanas, for presenting very valuable content. And also I thank CCPSL for organizing this event. It's a very important event. especially for our junior colleagues as well as for us. I think it's a eye opener since we are in the kind of service sector, a little bit away from the academic sector. So this kind of activities really open up our eyes to work into the academic sector and giving the touch for the academic side as well. So following up with Dr. Vinda, what Madam said about the study area where the countries are focused on this meta-analysis, it clearly shows that the some countries were prominently keeping in this different studies, being most are from China or some few from Italy and so on, and hardly any studies from South Asia as well. So it gives us to another stimulation that we need to focus on our studies as well, rather focusing on other studies as well. So I'm not commenting about the meta-analysis, but I'm just talking and giving a comment for the other audience as well. So it's high time to look into our studies as well, at least not the meta-analysis, at least for the some kind of the health workers related studies as well, since we are in a lot of junior colleagues who are very good in research. So it's time to take up some studies relevant to the health workers. Now, as example, if get the RDHS Kalutara itself having a 240 infected health workers at this moment. So it's a gives a high chance to do that kind of work. And also it is very much important us to get that information as well, how far, how long before they have vaccinated, and what is the symptom profile that now they are presenting. Was the symptom profile is different previously, and what is happening now is different. That kind of challenging questions are with us. So I think it's also something has to be think by our other colleagues as well. So thank you very much, Tiara and Shanaz, for presenting.
One last question. Just you mentioned that they have not done the risk of bias assessment, and isn't it an important element in systematic review? And what is your comment about it? Any Shana or Chiara can answer this.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much. That's why we started off by saying it's an important aspect, because every systematic review ideally should have a risk of bias assessment. So a major deficiency we saw in this review was that they have not done that. So maybe it's because of the limitation, maybe because of the time, or maybe they did not have the information they needed to carry it out. So they have not mentioned any of that. So it's just that they have said about a publication bias that had been addressed, but nothing else to do with this, the risk of bias assessment. So I suppose that's a take-home message for everyone who's planning on a systematic review, to incorporate that, which is a significant component of any systematic review.
So are you aware of any methods to do this risk of bias assessment? Just asking. Or any others can comment? How do we commonly do this? Because you missed that component when they very nicely did the presentation. I'm sure the audience missed that part. So can anyone, even Mahesh, Uddika, can you explain how this risk of bias assessment is? I mean, what are the options? What are the methods? When we usually go through systematic reviews, we hear about it, the methods, how they do it. Just a quick answer from someone. Singha? Oh.
Thanks, Madam. I'll give a brief account. I'm Mahesh here. So as you said, the risk of bias is a very important element. And even in that heterogeneity assessment, as Dr. Shanaz and Chiara mentioned, we should report on the clinical heterogeneity, methodological heterogeneity, as well as the statistical heterogeneity. And this risk of bias assessment is important in reporting this methodological heterogeneity as well. So there are various risk of bias assessment strategies depending on the study designs that we use for the particular synthesis. So if that is, let's say, a randomized controlled trial, if you are doing meta-analysis on that, we can use something like this grade criteria. And even for non-randomized studies, there are protocols that we can use, like Robbins-I protocol. So they could have easily used one of these for the systematic for the risk of bias assessment of these selected studies. So as you mentioned, and as our presenters also mentioned, it is an one of the important deficiencies that we see in this article. And we congratulate the presenters for picking that. I mean, even before we pointed that out. Thank you.
Thank you, Mahesh.
With that excellent answer from Dr. Buddhika Mahesh, we come to the end of just another successful Journal Club activity. And on behalf of the Council of College of Community Physicians in Sri Lanka, I would like to express my heartfelt gratitude to the three distinguished panel members who has spent your valuable time with us, with the young generation of community medicine trainees. Who have trainees to share your knowledge and wisdom. And also, I'd like to thank the two presenters for an excellent presentation. And last but not the least, to all the participants today who joined today in this Zoom session amid your busy working schedule. I conclude the event today, and I hope to see you again the another Journal Club activity in the future. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.